Good morning, afternoon, evening, whatever time you're listening to this. Mike Connolly, aka Mr. Stinky Cakes, with the Launching Standouts 100 Grand Plan Mastermind. Now, that's a mouthful. We got to narrow that down. Woo! It's a mouthful. Anyway, today we have my good friend, man, one of the best photographers I know, one of the best business minds I know. Seth is like, if you meet a man, he's like so cool and laid back to talk to, but he's the second he opens his mouth, you know, he's like borderline genius with his stuff, man. I just love watching him work. He's like a surgeon with how he does, and he does it with photography. It's amazing, man. I love Seth.
So thank you.
last week, Garnell, 100 Grand Plan, he got his new office space, and this guy walks in and say, "Hey, when you're done with my I think it was a screwdriver.
Yeah.
I'm right down the hall in room 202. Yeah, this guy's name is Seth. I'm like, wait, that sounds like my Seth, man. Hey, Seth, what's up, man? And the next thing you know, we're talking, and Seth agreed to be on the mastermind. So I'm going to shut up. I'm going to hand it over to Seth. Seth could tell us his story, who he is, what he does, and just kind of walk us down, you know, the path to business ownership and entrepreneurship and wherever you want to go with it, Seth. So, Seth, the floor is yours, my friend.
Yeah, thanks, Mike. Thanks for having me. It's a pleasure to be here and talking with all the people who have joined us today to talk about their businesses and tuned in to hear me talk about mine a little bit. So it's an honor to be here. So thank you for inviting me. Not sure where to look. So my camera's over here, but I know different people are different places on the screen. So if I'm looking over here, I'm just looking at different people. So my name is Seth Kaye. My business is Seth Kaye Photography. I'm a wedding and portrait photographer in Chicopee, Massachusetts. And I grew up in Springfield. I grew up there, went to UMass in Amherst, and which is where I started taking my photography seriously. In retrospect, it's something I'd always done. You know, family vacations and birthday parties and such, you know, looking back through old family photo albums, that was, turns out I'd taken the photos with the little Instamatics and the little flash cubes. Remember those flash cubes from back in the day? I had taken those photos. So it's always been a part of me. Those photos weren't any good. I was just a kid, but, it was something that I'd always done. It was just part of my DNA, and I didn't realize that until I started taking that path a little more seriously. So while I was at college, I joined the Collegian, the campus newspaper at UMass, and that's where I started. You know, photojournalism was one of the first things that I gravitated toward because it was telling other people's stories, and it also suited me pretty well as an introvert, because I could just watch people with my camera. I didn't really have to interact with them at the time. And that journey is something that I've had to work on as well, being an introvert. I think of myself now as a recovering introvert. So it's something that I've learned how to cope with over the years. And I learned early on that if you're starting your own business, you can't sit back and just let things wash over you. You have to take things on, and you have to insert yourself into networking events and know how to communicate with other people. So it's definitely something that's really important. Mike, you had a question.
I got a question there. That's a great point. So, and I know some people on here probably will consider themselves introverts too. So what's that like? Cause I'm an extrovert introvert. Like, I think I'm an introvert. Everyone tells me I'm an extrovert, but it's not about me. For someone that's a true introvert, mm-hmm. how do you network? How do you walk in a room full of people and network? It's kind of exactly what I was telling Lauren about promoting her business pre-call. Like, how do you do something that's not natural to you to help advance your business, like moving into a room?
I think everybody has their own path for that kind of thing. Everybody's a little bit different. For me, it was observing other people and seeing how they did it and trying to learn from their example of how to talk to people, how to make small talk, how to talk about your business and talk about yourself without it being too salesy, without being over the top and for me, it was a lot of learning how to be comfortable in my own skin, talking to other people. Because it's very, when you're an introvert, you're just in your head all the time. And I'm sure a lot of people are who don't identify as an introvert are in their heads all the time as well. But for me, it was hard. It was hard to insert myself into conversations without it being too much. I didn't want to be that guy. So it took a long time. So it's something that I still work on. I still find myself feeling a little awkward in certain situations, but an extroverted introvert is a good way to put it. I've heard people say that before, but I like to say recovering introvert, because I have some friends who are in recovery for their own things and their own personal things, and the stories that they tell. And when we talk about these things, it sounds like my own journey trying to be someone who can speak authoritatively about what they do, speak about their business, and do the things I need to do to grow my business.
Awesome. So it sounds like, because like on the back of my book, I say fear kills more dreams than lack of resources ever will. So it sounds like there you overcome a fear. Like I think that's one of the coolest things about being a business owner, being an entrepreneur. Like when you locked in to wanting to be successful in business, you do things that you don't even think is possible. Like you just like, we look back and go, whoa, I did that. Like, so I wanna ask a question. How long, you said you started taking pictures as a kid. How long before you turned it into a business?
It was a long time. When I graduated from UMass, I kept doing what I was doing, and I kept freelancing as a photographer. So I worked wherever I could, and I didn't do it full time at the time. I worked as a graphic designer, worked as a product photographer, and I did that. My first job out of college was second shift, which was great because those were the hours I was keeping in college anyway. So I would be up all night and then do other stuff during the day. So that first job enabled me to go out and photograph stuff during the day. I would go home midnight, 1 a.m. I had recorded some shows that I wanted to watch that were on during prime time, and the news was in there. So I would see what was going on the next day, see if there's anything worth photographing, and I would just go out and do it. And I did that for 15 years. So it was a lot of patience and a lot of perseverance trying to find my path. And I didn't turn it into...
One second. So yeah. 15 years, you were just out taking photos, not looking to turn a profit just because you love doing it. You were just taking photos.
It was a combination of the two. It was definitely something I love doing. It's something that I still love doing. But I was in my 20s. I didn't really have any idea about, and this was also in the 90s. So there wasn't, all these resources that are available to people today, which is right. Fantastic. I mean, I love the democratization that the internet has brought. You can just go on YouTube now and learn about these things. You can put something out on Facebook and ask a question, and you'll get a ton of people helping you out. And that just didn't exist at the time. So at the time, while I wanted to make it a profession and make it how I paid my bills, I just didn't know how to. So that was just a matter of trial and error and learning along the way, meeting people who had already done this. So it's definitely safe to say that I wouldn't be doing this now if not for the generosity of others, sharing their information, sharing their experience with me.
Seth, give them your website so they can look at some of your stuff while we're talking too.
Sure, it's sethkaye.com, and that's sethkaye.com.
All right, cool. I'm gonna put it in the chat too. All right, you can keep going. sethkaye.com.
Yes, that's my website.
I just put it in the chat for everyone too, so you can check out some of his work.
Thank you. And my Instagram is @sethk. So it's same thing, sethkaye. So that's my Instagram.
That's so funny too. I always forget the new technology. As much as I tell people to use it, I go to the default stuff, website, phone number. I had someone buy my book the other day and they used Cash App. And I was like, yeah, you're right. I never even give people that option. I go to my website. Just, it's cool. It's the technology that's coming, man. And it's here. It's amazing. All right, Seth, I'm going to shut up again.
Oh yeah, no, it's all good. This back and forth is fantastic. But yeah, turning my photography into a profession, something that I was able to pay my bills with, it did take a long time. And photojournalism wasn't my path. I loved it, and I feel it's a very important thing to do. I admire photojournalists and journalism in general. I think it's just a noble profession, and the opportunity for someone to be in a place where most people aren't and tell a story of what's going on and share that with the world, I think is a really powerful thing. But it's something that after doing it for that long, I burned out on it a little bit, because you see a lot of stuff. The news isn't always nice, you may have noticed. So seeing that firsthand all the time started to take its toll. And even though I wasn't doing it full time at the time, I started to take that stuff home with me, and it really wasn't good for my emotional well-being. And coincidentally, at the same time, I discovered wedding photography, which was never on my radar when I was younger. Because at the time, in the 90s, wedding photography was really looked down on as the subs. You don't want to talk to wedding photographers. They were the lowest of the low. And at the time, a lot of it was super cheesy, and it wasn't anything that I wanted anything to do with.
Okay.
But a friend of mine at some point, he was getting married, and he said, "Seth, we know you don't photograph weddings, but we really like your work, and we'd really like you to photograph ours. And we promise not to hate you if the pictures stink." So we're still friends. So I guess I did a decent enough job. And I was so nervous. I didn't know what to do. And I could, because I didn't have that what was at the time the traditional wedding photography background, which was really more portraiture. And it was very, not anything I wanted to be a part of. It wasn't creative in my view. So when it came time for me to do that, I photographed it the only way I knew how, which was as a storyteller, which was as a photojournalist. And that really informed how I continue to do things now. So while portraits portraits are a part of weddings, it's something that I really had to work at, how to make a portrait that wasn't standard, that wasn't just a picture of who was there and what they were wearing. I want to take portraits of people to show who they are and what they were feeling and what their personality is really like, not just, poking their heads up from behind a tree. That was the kind of stuff I really didn't want to do. And if someone likes that, I'm not gonna photo shame anyone. It's just not how I wanted to present my own work. Right. And something that I worked on over the years and joined some online forums and just really worked really hard to be the kind of photographer I want to be. And one thing I like about creative pursuits is you never reach that goal. You're always, I've had this business now for, I think 2005 is when I started it, and we're in 2019 now. So 14 years I've had this business. And I've in a lot of respects, I feel like I'm just getting started. I've had a lot of people say some really nice things about my work online, and then I made some lists and, won some awards, and that's great. It's humbling and it's flattering. But I want to make great images for the people that hire me. I don't do it for awards. I don't do it for recognition. I do it because I want to make great photos for the people that are having this amazing day. And I want to tell their story and put something down on, I almost said on film, but put something down to so that people can, so that they can look back on this day in the future and say, this is what our day was really like. And if kids are in their future, I want the kids to be able to look at those photos years later and say, this is what the day was like when my family started. Because I have in my office here, I have some my grandparents' wedding photos, and that means a lot to me. That's family history. And while photojournalism is current events that become history, wedding photography and family portraiture, it's about family history. It's personal history. So while the work that I do is doesn't have the reach that it once did, being published in newspapers and magazines and such, to me, what I'm doing now is far more meaningful, because it means something to individuals. yeah, hopefully it can bring them joy as the years go on.
I think that's so cool, man, because you took what you were doing and turned it into a career in a different genre and kept it like unique to you. Like you didn't like in the music industry, like you didn't sell out. Like you stayed true to, you know, what you wanted to do. It was like, but you saw an opportunity. It's crazy because, and now that you said it, like I'm thinking back to my mom's wedding pictures or my in-laws' wedding pictures, and it's just that pose, like, and but wedding photography today is so different. And I if you didn't say that, I would have never thought about that. But it's because of guys like you that stayed true to your vision and understanding. This is not about posing. This is about storytelling. That whole industry is different. Like people now, that one of the first things people book, besides the wedding hall, is a photographer.
Yeah.
Like it's like that's a big thing. So that's really cool to see that. And I mean, it's cool too that you studied your industry, and not only your industry but your customer, and knowing what they really wanted. Like it's funny because I read something that Henry Ford said about creating the Model T. And what Ford said was he never really asked the people what they wanted, because if he asked them, they would have said they wanted a faster horse, right? But he knew they wanted a faster horse, so he gave them the version of the faster horse in creating the Model T. And I think you did the same thing with your customers, because they would have asked for what they can vision, what they can picture. Well, yeah, we want to stand behind the tree. And like you said, that's fine if you want to do that. But let's tell that story that you're going towards that tree, everything behind it. Let's tell the whole story. I think that's absolutely great. It makes me think of Indian Lamont with veganist foodies in their sauce. When they started, they just wanted to eat healthier. Like, you know, they wanted to eat healthy. That's how they started. And it progressed. So now they were eating healthy and they, you know, putting out these meal plans and all this other stuff. And one of the cool things that happened organically for them was they developed a sauce to go with the foods, the new healthier foods they were eating, right? And then now they're selling the sauce. It was an organic process, but them staying true to themselves and then introducing people to their world. Like is a cool thing when that happens like that. Like that, even with Stinky Cakes, like I literally just wanted diapers. And like, I gotta make diaper giving fun, right? So I became obsessed with knowing what the problem was, solving it in ways that people would appreciate it, and then creating a system for them to be able to purchase them. I think that's great, man. I never knew that part of your stories. I think it's cool understanding that. And it actually helps me understand your mind a whole lot more, because you're a strategic thinker. Now I see the strategy in that. That's really cool.
Oh, thanks. No, thanks for saying that. And yeah, you definitely hit a couple nails on the head there. And when I was starting this, maybe I had a misunderstanding of things at the time, but I felt I had two roads to build my business. It's find a need and fill it, which I think is a traditional business mode, or do what I want to do and then find my audience. And I knew that was going to be the harder way to go,
right?
Because I read a lot of Seth Godin at the time, and that was one of the things that he talked about. Maybe not in those exact words, but that's what I took from it. And it was because I didn't want to do what other people were doing. I want to do my own thing. And I equate that now to when people come to me for weddings or portraits, and they come with a Pinterest board and they say, oh, can we do this? And while we can use that as a jumping off point, I don't want to recreate other people's work. And I think that's what a lot of, you know, traditional wedding photography and portraiture was at the time. It's some people want to know exactly what they're going to get, and that's fine. But that's not the kind of work I wanted to do. I wanted to do something that was different every time. And sometimes I succeed and sometimes I don't. Hopefully I succeed more often than I don't. But I do my best every time for everybody that hires me. So following my own bliss, following my own creative muse, I was able to find people who want that kind of thing, because I feel that speaks more to those individuals' personalities rather than the people who know the kinds of images that they want. Because the way I do things, you don't always know. You know, hopefully people can look at my portfolio and look at my work, and after meeting me, hopefully trust that you know, I'm going to do my best for them. But it's going to be different than what they've seen on my website. But what they see on my website and what they see in my Instagram is indicative of the kind of work that I do. I don't want to repeat myself, and I don't want to repeat right. what other people have done. So that's a little bit harder road. But I think, you know, having a business for 14 years, and when the statistics are most businesses don't last 5 years, is that it?
5 years.
Yeah. So and now I'm able to you know, pay my bills some years better than others, but you know, because it's you know, businesses, they go up and they go down, and I'm grateful for everyone that's hired me and who's supported me over the years to do the kind of work I want to do for them.
So I got a question. We talked about this when we went in your studio. So some people, you said a lot of photographers, like every other businesses, fail. But one of the things you're saying, like a lot of the people, they don't have a business sense. So my question to you is, like, how did you figure out your pricing? How did you figure out what you were worth? How did you figure out who your customers were that would pay for at your price point? Like, how'd you figure that whole system out?
It was trial and error in the beginning. Again, 2005, you know, the resources available then, there were resources, but they weren't like they are now. And I'm a little envious of people now who are starting their businesses,
because what I say.
So many people that can help you. And there's so many resources out there where you can, just find great information. So I think a lot of people, and I was exactly the same way, I copied what other people were doing. You know, here's what the market can bear. This is what other people are charging. This is how other people are doing it. And, you know, not knowing any different, I was younger at the time. And I just kind of figured it out. And the things that were working for me, I doubled down on. The things that weren't working for me, I abandoned. And over time, things evolved to get to a point where I was able to be profitable, and I was able to leave the old day job behind. And that's still an evolution. You know, the market changes every couple of years, sometimes yearly. You know, as the economy goes up and down, as people's tastes change, as more people get into the business, as some people leave the business. So it's a constantly evolving thing, and trying to stay ahead of those trends is something that that for me is a current challenge, and something that you know, I say bring it on.
No, that was a great answer. How long before you went from what I like to call working 16, working 8 hours somewhere else, and then working 8 hours in your business? How long before you were able to go from go full time in your business and leave your job?
3 years. 3 years. I decided this is the path, like weddings was the path for me, that it was not only creatively satisfying, but also from a business perspective, more profitable than photojournalism was. And as much as I love that, and you know, as I mentioned earlier, I was getting a little burned out on that and sort of floundering. I didn't know where to go. I didn't know what to do. And then my friends invited me to photograph their wedding, and that set me on this path that I'm on today. So I came up with a 3-year plan, I was able to do that. So I grew my business to a point where I was too busy with photographing weddings to do that and my day job. And also, thankfully, corresponded with being profitable enough to be able to leave the day job behind.
That's why I wanted you on, Seth, because I know how strategic you are. And I like the whole 100 grand plan thing. All it is a strategy, right? It gives you staff guidelines to follow. It's not even about the money, really, because if we were talking about the money that this talk about being made in it, John's talking about how he made $120 million selling teddy bears. So really it'd be the $120 million plan. It's the 100 grand plan because it's strategic. It's things that's measurable. You can know if you head in the right direction or not. You can make adjustments. It's all based on logic and taking the right steps. That being said, your three-year plan, what did that look like? What did that entail?
It entailed working a lot of hours. I'd have the day job. I would come home and work on photos. I would, after work, I would schedule meetings with people. I would go to their homes. I would meet them in coffee shops. I would, bring sample albums with me. I would bring price lists with me. I would bring a laptop with sample images on it. And it was a lot of R&D, a lot of asking other people what they were doing, and tailoring their answers to what worked for me. So I wish there was more specific things I could share, but it was more of a broad.
That's perfect. That's perfect, Seth, because I want to segue into the LBW. Like that what you did that made you profitable enough to leave your job, it was not luck. It was, you did the work. It was sounded like a lot of long work, a lot of lonely work, a lot of born work and beating people. And I figure, looking like Clark Kent and Superman switching to go from, 9 to 5 to what I really do. Was that easy for you? Was it like a walk in the park? Was it like, oh, this is great. What was that experience like?
It was tiring. it was a lot of hours. Sometimes I would meet people after work. I would drive, I'm based in Western Massachusetts. So I'd drive to the Worcester area. I would drive into Connecticut. I would go into Vermont because I didn't have a space to meet people. And it was a lot of pounding the pavement, a lot of contacting venues to network with them, a lot of trying to network with other people in the area, DJs, other photographers. And then after that, I would go home and work on the photos. Sometimes I would work on my pricing, but a lot of that was just, the LBW, sitting behind a computer all by myself, working on the photos, working on trying to make things better. And I know I'm not alone in that. I know a lot of other people did the same thing. Some photographers do that now. And not just photographers, if you have a day job that you need to pay the bills, I know people that they've gone home and they've written books and they worked on their poetry and they worked on their paintings. And, it's just something that you have to do if you want to get to that next step.
Awesome. Well, how much of your success, you said, what, you've been 14 years now?
Officially started my business in 2005, left the old day job 3 years after that.
So how much your success would you accredit to those first 3 years where you were just grinding it out, doing all that crazy work? Like, how much of your success would you give credit to for now?
I think
totally asked it all wrong because my Bahamian dialect switched in there somewhere and I lost my train of thought. So forgive me on that.
For me, success is a moving target. My first measure of success was being able to do this full time, being able to do the day job behind. And, my next measure of success was getting on referral lists for certain venues. And then it was hitting a certain financial milestone. And, at some point it was winning certain awards and it was getting on certain lists of, best of lists. And so these things, they do change over time. And, my measure of success these days, having been doing this for a long time, is to lead the life I want to live. And that's not just financial. And in fact, the financial part is actually a smaller part of it. It's being able to take time out of my day and talk with you and all the people that are joining us. Being able to go out and have coffee with my friends whenever I want, if there are no deadlines, hanging over my head. And it's being able to, if there's nothing else going on. I don't owe anybody any photos. It's being able to take the afternoon off and going to see the new Avengers movie before all the spoilers come online.
You're right. I totally get that. It's funny because I took my kids to see it and it was right after school. I was like, bro, only way we're going to see this is if we go now.
Yeah,
it was a guy that I know. He was there. He's like, "What are you doing there, Mr. Entrepreneur? You supposed to be working." I go, "Nah, man. Being an entrepreneur is the reason I could be here. You got the money making the money while you can spend a couple of dollars. But nah, there's so many cool things about being an entrepreneur, man. I know Lauren's gonna have to jump up in a second. Lauren, I don't know if you have any questions. I'm open up for some questions in between. Any questions or anything you guys want to say to Seth? Lauren, you can go first.
Hey, Seth. So I didn't realize Seth K was the one doing this call at first. I had hopped on without reading the summary. We met like in 2010 when I worked for a wedding film company, and I actually interviewed you you were first starting.
I remember.
So if I can find the old article I saved, I'll send it to you later.
Oh, that'd be great. Thanks.
So I had a question, I guess, following up with like the introverted sales. Would you say that sort of networking in your area is like your biggest form of advertising at the moment?
Advertising is a tricky thing for me. I don't think I do any print advertising anymore. I know a lot of people are in the same boat, you know. Anything that I do for advertising and marketing, it's either online or in person. So I do think a lot of my marketing is in person. It's sometimes meeting people for coffee. It's sometimes going to a venue and just stopping in and saying hi to the salespeople. Sometimes it's local networking groups. And other people do more of this, other people do less of this. You know, working on my SEO is a really important thing for me because I have a lot of couples who, if they're getting married here, maybe they don't live in the area. So, you know, maybe they grew up here, went to college here, but they're now coming back. So they're not going to find me through those other means. They're going to find me online. So both in person, working on my SEO and working on my social media presence are big things for me. I hope that answers your question.
Yeah, thank you.
Any other questions for Seth?
Maybe everyone's an introvert.
I so am. I can relate to that.
Can I be heard?
It's hard. You know, I was going to say, you know, raising your hand and asking a question is part of that as well. And it takes a lot of effort to do that. And you have to purposefully put yourself in positions where you might fail, but you also might succeed. For me, you know, I remember that there was one turning point for me. There was someone I connected with and they invited me to a party they were having. And it was a, you know, kind of a networking thing, kind of get together thing. And I'd only just recently met that person. And I knew I wasn't going to know anybody else at this get together. And I remember saying to myself, if I can get through this, if I can not embarrass myself, if I can, you know, talk with people I've never met before, if I can get through this, I can do anything. And I did. I was there the whole time. And that for me was a big turning point in, you know, having in building my self-confidence to go out and meet people and talk to people that I've never met before. And it's you know, for me, that was a really big step. So I'd encourage you, anyone that feels that way, to put themselves in a position where they might fail, hopefully not publicly. and not online, but you know, in positions where you can learn from that experience, you can see what other people are doing and try to see what works for you.
It's so true. And once you step in that zone and you figure out like how to work the room or how to do it in a way where you're still comfortable, it becomes like out of body experience, man. I remember the first time I did public speaking. And before I did it, I made it such a big deal in my head. And then, like, I was talking to someone. And he was like, "Mike, just talk to three people." Like, "Yeah, but it's like 500 people." "No, just talk to three people." one on the left side, one in the middle, one on the right. Every time you turn your head, the people over there are going to think you're talking to all of them. The people over here are going to think you're talking to all of them. People over here, and it, you just work the room. But find three friendly faces. Like, every situation that you put yourself in, there's a way to master it. Like, even like you teach kids who studying for the SAT, don't just try to remember the word, create mnemonic aids. And now you're remembering the thing based on something else that had nothing to do with the thing, but you remember the word and the meaning. Like, there's always ways to play tricks with your mind. Because you got to understand that you're unstoppable. You're fearless. You're built for this. You could do this. But you got to figure out ways to how to tap into your mind to make that happen. Like, so much of the stuff is like headspace. Like, you sometimes you're your own worst enemy. And I'm not saying like these different things aren't real, but I'm saying you're built to deal with it. You just got to figure out how you're built to deal with it. Like, what I'm hearing Seth say is, you know, how he does it may be different how you do it, but just know you can do it. Let's find your way to do it. It makes me think of when myself, Indy, and Lamont went down to this event in New York, and Indy was like, I'm shy to talk. And I look up, Indy is talking to the CEO of the company. The CEO is asking me, hey, you know these guys? They're from Springfield too? And she was working the room. Everyone knew who they were and what they did. By the time I went down back in the basement, a lot of people were talking about veganist foodies, and it was because they were just talking about the business. And it was a warm environment, but this was New York and we didn't know anybody. And you know, it's always a way to do what you want to do, man. You just got to read. That's why I always say, love yourself, believe in yourself, invest in yourself at all times. Chantel, who was that?
Oh, that was me. I was going to just add to that, after you have a certain amount of experience in whatever your field is, you can speak with authority on that particular thing. So you have a built-in, just talk about what you know about. If you know about photography, if you know about vegan foods, you know, you can speak with authority on that. And there are people, there's an audience for that. There are people who want to hear from you. And, you don't have to talk about the things that make you uncomfortable. You can talk about the thing that drives you. You can talk about the things that you're passionate about. And people will listen to that.
It's true. So true. Yeah. It's like, you're so right about that, Seth, because someone that may be afraid to talk about business or whatever it may be, and they're like the biggest Celtic fan, and they'll go out and talk about the Celtics. Oh, but you talk about Kyrie Irving is this and that. Like, but I thought you were scared to talk to people. Yeah, no, not when it comes to the Celtics. So that's another thing. Like, that's a good part of like tricking your mind too, knowing your thing. And when you know your thing, you just, that goes back to the LBW. You spend all this time doing this longly born work, so you become a subject matter expert. So you know your thing. So your confidence will come from your thing. That's your cape. That's your Superman outfit, is you being knowledgeable in your field. Someone else was about to ask something. I think it was it you, Chantel?
I was, and at this point, I don't know if I remember what it was because it's taken such a big turn. But I guess where my concern is, with the networking and the discipline. So my biggest issue that I have is I just joined a co-working space because I found myself falling behind, at home and trying to do coffee shops and doing different places. And I never knew where I was going to be for the day. So I was really excited. And then I left my laptop at home. So that's a whole nother story. But what I'm wondering about is kind of like the discipline of not getting so overwhelmed with every opportunity, possibility, people inboxing me. I get people that love inboxing me advice that I did not ask for on how to do my business. And I was like, at what point did I say I was curious? And I don't want to sound mean, but it's like, I don't have time to read everything people send me, but I also don't want them to send it to me anymore. So I don't know if you experienced that or how you kind of manage that flow of information and on your time.
I, well, Yeah, I get those things too. I get those things all the time. And sometimes it's just spam. You could just hit the spam button if it's not anybody that you know. If it is somebody you know, it's a little trickier. But learning, for me, learning how to say no to what might have been opportunities is important because you can't, there's only so many hours in the day, and you have to do, you know, sometimes you have to do the work. Sometimes you have to do the work that nobody sees, you know, sitting there in QuickBooks, for example, or working on price lists. But so learning how to say no to things that aren't, that may be well-meaning, but that won't drive your business forward, that won't, it's going to take up time that you could better spend on things that will drive your business forward. And that's tricky. You know, sometimes if I have a light week or a light schedule, yeah, I might do it because it seems like fun. And I don't discount the idea of things that might be fun, because, you know, one of the reasons I got into this is because I love what I do. And there are things that I do that don't pay well. Sometimes I do volunteer my time. Sometimes I do things that pay a little less than what I would ordinarily charge because it's going to be a lot of fun. And sometimes I do it because, oh, this could be a good networking opportunity. So even if this particular thing doesn't pay what I need it to pay to pay my bills, maybe I'll meet somebody there who might hire me in a few months, or that could be a jumping off point to something else. So while I photograph a lot of weddings, I also do a lot of commercial work. So in some of my commercial work, I've met people who said, oh, hey, my daughter's getting married. Can we contact you and talk about that? Well, sure. And that's worked the other way too. I've done some weddings where I've met some people who said, oh, I have this business and I need some headshots. Can you help me out with that? And things build. You never know where the next opportunity is going to come from. So saying no is very important to your own well-being, for your business and for your mental health. You also, I think, have to be open to the possibilities that any point of contact might bring.
Awesome. That's a great answer. I love that.
Thank you. Yeah.
My pleasure.
Garnell, you got anything for Seth, man?
Yeah, I'm here. I think I had a few questions for you, Seth. Sorry about that, guys. I was going to chime in a little early when you were asking, but I had to take a phone call. So I missed a little bit. So hopefully I don't ask no repetitive questions. So I know you do photography and you do wedding photography. And I myself was interested in getting involved in some videography for weddings as well. And I'm actually working out a couple things with a couple clients now, or potential clients at least. However, my question for you is, why don't you, and not just in your industry, but in general, I know a lot of people don't post their prices online. Some people do, some don't. What's your take on that?
I personally don't. There are arguments for and against. And it's something that I have conversations with people about since I've been in business. But I don't know that I ever have. Because for me, I don't want people to choose me simply because of price. I want people to choose me because they feel I'm the best person for the job. And with wedding photography, for example, most of the people that contact me have never done this before. They've never gotten married before. They've never gone through this process. So they don't know what questions to ask. And that's not a dig against anybody. They just don't have the experience. But what most people do have experience with is what things cost. So people will often default to send me a price list. Let's talk about price before anything else, because I might not be the right fit for them. I might be the best fit for them. But if they see a price list without any context, that might cut off any opportunity that we might have to work together. So, you know, because I'm not the least expensive photographer in the area, I don't want to scare people away. I want to have a conversation, and I want the opportunity to sell them on what I can do for them. So to me, a price list without context it's just, at least in my field, I feel it can keep people at arm's length, because they see a certain price and they have an idea in their head, and that they're going to say, no, that's just, we can't do that. But if I have the opportunity to talk to them first, I have the opportunity to convince them that my experience, And the way I do things might be the best thing for them. And they might say, you know what? We thought we were going to spend this, but we really want this. And, you know, maybe we'll cut out something else in order to afford this. Or maybe they'll say, you know what? We can't afford this, and we'll find a way to make it work. So that's why I don't personally post my pricing online. I'm happy to share it with anybody. So after I have a conversation with those people, I send it right out to them. So there's no, I don't want to keep things hidden. I don't believe in hiding anything. I'm kind of an open book when it comes to that. Even other vendors, you know, I've been shopped by other vendors, which is kind of shady. You know, they pretend that they're a client and say, send me your price list. And I'm more than happy to just send it to people. I have nothing to fear from that with other vendors. But I think with the general public, they don't necessarily have the background or the experience to know, you know, what certain things will cost. You know, maybe vegan foods are very specific, so maybe it does cost more than McDonald's. So people need to be convinced that this is a better product, this is better for them, and it's worth the extra money.
Great. Okay. Thank you so much. I think I got like another question or two if nobody else has any.
No, go on, Garnell.
Yeah.
All right, cool. So another thing is, I know especially in creative fields, like what me and you do, I know a big thing, I mean, I don't know if you still have it going on, but you know, you have friends, you have family. How do you deal with that? Because everybody, you know, expects certain things or wants certain discounts, and kind of how do you deal with that stuff?
Generally, my family doesn't ask. You know, I know some people, their motto on that is with friends and family, I'm either doing it for free or we're doing it at full price. Because with discounts, I think conversations are good to have. Because if someone wants to spend, you know, multiple thousands of dollars on my service, and if I can say, well, I'll take $100 off in order to get $2,000, $3,000, $4,000, $5,000, you know, that's an easy calculus for me. But with, you know, cutting something in half, trying to meet someone else's pricing, you know, that race to the bottom is doesn't benefit anyone. You know, the thing, and this is a Seth Godin thing, you know, the problem with a race to the bottom is you might win. And that's a surefire way to go out of business. So with friends and family, you know, I have photographed friends' weddings, and they pay full price. They don't ask, to be honest, because my other friends that I photograph, they are photographers themselves, or they're DJs, or they're in the industry, and they know that, you know, they wouldn't want someone to ask them that. But what I can do for those people is give them more. So while I'm not in a position to charge less in most cases, I can be there a couple extra hours. I can give them a larger album. So there are some things that I can do for people who are, you know, close to me in my life.
Okay. And then I think the last one I wrote down was, so when you aren't booked, or when it's not wedding season, or, you know, not as much, obviously you have some edits, but when you're not doing the edit business-wise, what do you occupy your time doing typically?
A lot of times the winter is a slower season, because not as many people get married in the winter. So that's an opportunity to work on my pricing and work on my marketing, see what's going on in the area, in the country, around the world, with you know, both business things, with artistic things, and trying to see if there's something I can do to push my business forward in order to get ahead of whatever trends are coming up. So yeah, sometimes the downtime, and there's never really downtime, you know, and sometimes there are things you push off. You know, there are personal projects that I have that I back burner when business picks up, and so I can work on those. And sometimes I just take the day off, man.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Oh, you're welcome.
I'm taking a picture of the picture. Lamont, what you got for Seth?
Oh, first I want to say we were checking out your pictures, and they're absolutely beautiful.
Thank you.
Really breathtaking. I like them. And we actually are looking to connect with Garnell to take a professional picture of our bottle of sauce. But we also want to get a camera for ourselves to, because we do a lot of things on our phone, like recording and making our own content. Mm-hmm. What would you say would be like the best camera to start with that has multiple use for the things that we do to create the content for our social media?
Tell them a little bit more of the type of content you create. Just explain it a little bit.
We do our own videos. I don't know. We make a lot of videos, a lot of food videos, a lot of educational videos showing people different shortcuts and alternatives that they could use to implement in their cooking or just on their daily, daily in and out.
And then they take a lot of still shots of the food too that they do. And so, custom photos, like if someone's holding the bottle with sauce or something like that. So stuff like that. So what will be a good camera for something for them to do stuff like that?
That's a great question. And I get that question a lot, actually. And it's really, the technology is at a point right now, it's really hard to go wrong with most things. Amazon reviews are your friends if you're looking for something specific. So it's hard for me to and things change so frequently, it's hard for me to recommend anything specific. For a lot of people's uses, phone cameras have just gotten crazy good. So if you're able to light things well enough, chances are your phone's gonna be a great starting point. If you want specific things that your phone isn't able to do, then maybe it's time to up your game and go to something that's a little more professional. It depends where you are in your particular field, where you are in trying to capture those videos and those four photos. Maybe Garnell would be a good person to ask, about the video stuff, because I don't do any video. It's something that is I admire a lot, but it's not. I concentrate on still photography myself. So if you want to email me afterwards, if you want to have a conversation, we can talk a little more in depth. But if you're on the whole, if you're able to look things pretty well, a newer cell phone camera is going to be a good place to start, and then up your game from there.
I was just going to say, do you use light boxes, or do you have a recommendation of lighting sources?
I don't have one of those because I have a lot of studio lighting and I have a lot of pro gear. So, but I know what those light boxes are and what they can do. So if you have things that will fit into those boxes, if they're, yay big, those are great solutions because it'll give you a nice seamless background. It'll light things pretty evenly. You don't need, it's not a huge capital expenditure to get one of those. So yeah, those are a great place to start.
Thank you.
I wanted to say thank you for your time and coming on and giving us this good information. But the question I wanted to ask you was pretty much piggybacking on what Garnell and what India were just saying. The technology is here. And in your downtime, you said that, you try to find things to help you advance. How do you consider adjust to the fact that everybody has a phone now? Mm-hmm. And take their own still pictures or make their own digital printouts and have like the free printing for pictures and stuff like that. Like, how do you, maybe like, how does that compete? Is it because you've been a legend in the game for so long, you kind of have your own lane, or is it more, you just stay on the cutting edge of everybody?
It's an interesting point. And that point is an ongoing challenge with a lot of more established photographers, because while the technology has democratized many industries, which I think is fantastic, and I love that anyone can jump into this now, and if they have something to say, if they have a vision, they can just do it. They don't need permission from a publisher or a network. They can just do this themselves, publish it themselves, broadcast it themselves, and I truly love that exists. But for people who do this in a more commercial vein, it it does mean a slightly more saturated market. So for making images, for example. So it is a different marketplace now than it was when I started, but it's for me, it's part of the game. You know, it is what it is. There's no point lamenting of, you know, kids these days, because if they're doing better work than me, they deserve it. You know, they deserve the accolades, they deserve the money. And that means I just have to work harder to you know, keep on top of things, you know, put more hours in with people who are younger than me, who have more energy. And it's a thing for sure. So it's just gotta work harder.
Yeah, so you're just always adapting. I mean, that makes perfect sense. I didn't know if there was like some secret insider stuff that you can give us if you're on the mastermind call.
Well, I appreciate you saying that.
What it is, man. You gotta go you find out the ins and outs of whatever industry.
I appreciate you saying that, but no, there's no secret sauce. I wish that there were. It's just hard work. It's never resting on your laurels. It's always working harder to get better at what you do, both on the artistic side, both on the business side, and you know, hopefully you don't make too many missteps along the way. Hopefully you put some systems into place that can cover you if you make a slight misstep. And those opportunities exist now as well, that where they didn't before. And I'm sure Mike, you know, can speak more to that with passive income versus active income. I can't speak to that with the authority that he can. And so that's my 2 cents on that.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Any other questions before we wrap it up? Dun, 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 dun. Now's the chance.
I just wanted to say that my favorite part of your story was when you were saying that it wasn't your plan and that you never wanted to do wedding photography, because I'm a firm believer that a lot of people, like, we always feel like we're in control, and the things that we choose to do doesn't really bring us the results that we're looking for. And a lot of times, like, if you would have been, like, stubborn or said, like, oh, no, I don't like weddings, I think, like, because it was your friend, you didn't think nothing of it. Like, you're doing your friend a favor. But your friend actually did you a favor because he, like, boosted your bank account and, like, you're happy doing what you wanted to do. And it wasn't even your plan to do it. So I love that.
Oh, well, yeah, thank you for saying that, too. And it's very true. He did do me a favor. By asking me to photograph his wedding. And now, you know, these days, wedding photography is it's considered really cool. Seemingly everybody wants to do it. It is a lot of fun. It's not for everybody because there are no do-overs at weddings. So if you miss something, you've missed it. You know, you can't recreate a first kiss. I mean, you can, but then it's not the first kiss.
Wait, say the vows again. My battery fell out.
things happen and you can't, you know, and for that reason, this particular field isn't for everybody. I think everybody tries it at least once. And there are couples out there who have very modest budgets and I'm very respectful of that. And not everybody, you know, not everybody has a Kardashian budget. I wish that they did, but that's just not true. And there are people who will cater to that market. You know, people who are just starting out. Maybe they're a student. Maybe they're just starting out. Everybody starts somewhere. Everybody has their first wedding. Everybody cooks their first meal. Everybody shoots their first video. Everybody has their first experience with doing these things. And if they're fortunate enough to be able to do it for years and years, you could look back on those days and go, wow, what was I thinking? But that's really the genesis of what you're doing now. So while there might be more competition in your field now, while technology might have democratized things, there's no substitute for experience in any field.
Sure. Yeah, man.
1,000% true. And that's in any field, man. And the cool part is, you become Neo in the Matrix when you go through it. Like, it's like once you hit, who's the mastery guy? I forget his name. Gladwell. He talks about Gladwell. Yeah, he talks about the 10,000 hours, and I'm trying to get my basketball team to appreciate this, because I tell them, like, hey guys, you're 13 and 14 right now, man. You're supposed to be missing layups, but if you're supposed to be missing shots because you're still learning. But if you do it shooting the right way. Get 10,000 hours shooting the right way. Don't every time you shoot do something different, because now you're not mastering nothing. But when you get to that, it's like, even me, like before I was a writer, I used to think I was a horrible writer. And then someone told me, Mike, just keep writing, because it's going to be like magical. Like one day it's just going to click and you're going to feel like you really know what you're doing. And like now it you hit that. Like it's a grind. It's a process. It's work. That's the part that I don't like about the internet and what the internet tells people about running a business. They tell them, oh, get your online store, run a Facebook ad, and then tomorrow you'll be bringing in. No, it doesn't work that way. You have to, there's so many things you have to understand. There's so many pieces. All the blocks could be in front of you. Just like, it's literally like putting together even a simple puzzle, a 12-piece puzzle. The first time you do that, you get, corners, boom, boom, boom. Oh, okay, I noticed the middle piece, pop, 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 then you're done. But that don't happen right away. And it's the same thing with business. If it's a complicated business or a not so complicated business, you still got to put that time in to understand it. Like you guys know, I always say the formula is to run a successful business is generating revenue. 1 + 1 = 2. That simple. Product and service plus people that want or need that product or service, financial transaction and exchange happen, boom. You get the money, they get the product or service. But you still got to figure out what that product and service is, and more importantly, who wants or need that product and service and who willing to pay what your price is. And I love the fact that Seth said, there's different people with different budgets, and is different photographers for those different budgets. Once you know where you at and know who your customer is and know who would pay for it, you're almost at the point where you're making yourself an ATM machine, your business ATM machine. Because now, and this is the part that I love where technology is today, like you literally don't even have to know these people anymore. You did your work. You found out who your core audience is. You got your buyers list. You could take that list of emails, you take that list of names and phone numbers, and places like Facebook and Google and these other ad networks will spit out people that are similar to those people. So you don't ever have to go swimming in the shallow part of the pool if you at the deep end, because they're going to tell you, hey, listen, you don't know this lady in Albuquerque, but trust me, she wants what you got. Right? It's so important going through it, because you go through it and know exactly who your customer is, exactly what they, all of that boring stuff. Mm-hmm. That's your gold mine. That's your asset. When you're ready to exit your business and sell it, that's the thing that people are going to buy. They're going to buy all that brand equity that you build up, but they're going to buy the people that would buy from them, because they're going to sell them your stuff and more stuff like it. And that's to them, that's where the value is. So always remember that, man. And I will always, until I no longer exist on this earth, I will always preach LBW. I teach it to my basketball students. I say it to you guys. I say it to I run my household on LBW. Like, if more people embrace that, I promise you the 95% that fail in the first 5 years, that number would go down dramatically if people just embraced it. Like, that's why when you go to the Basketball Hall of Fame, all those hundreds of thousands of people that played basketball, only a few hundred up in the halo. Those are the people that really, really embrace the LBW. Those in any industry, any arena, the people that embrace that and do it and go through it, blood, sweat, and tears. And then you always know who they really are, because, like, you look at Seth, there's no doubt that he didn't do the LBW. He's sitting here right now telling you what it is. And you guys are feeling like, okay, that makes sense. It makes sense, because LBW doesn't lie. It's the liars come from everybody talking about, oh, I posted this thing and I made $200,000 in 2 minutes. Yeah, but they're not telling you about the part when it took them 15, 20 years to build that list to do that. That's really where that happened. That was not a 2-minute process. So anyway, I'm getting fired up on this one because you guys, that part, man, I hate seeing people fail because of the BS like that. So I always get passionate about that.
And those are all amazing points. You know, you do have to know who your audience is, so you can say no to the people who aren't your audience, and say yes to the people who will drive your business forward and enable you to live the life you want to lead. And also too, to the earlier point, there's no shortcut to any of this. There's just patience and perseverance, in my opinion. You know, there's no fast track. There's just doing the work.
100%. Thank you.
I got another question for you, Seth, before you go.
Yeah.
What is your take on discounts in general, though? Because everybody has a different take on it. Some people believe that it's bad for business. Some people believe that you should do it in certain situations. Some people believe that it shows people that you should only purchase from me maybe when I do discounts. And what's your take on it, basically?
That's another topic that, you know, a lot of my friends and I talk about from time to time. And it depends what you mean by discount. Some people have, you know, for people who are in the military or police officers or firefighters, you know, sometimes they offer 5 or 10%, you know, discount for, you know, those public servants. You know, discount, if someone comes to me and says, will you match what this other person is charging? You know, it's between you and this other person. Will you match their price? And usually I'll say no, because they don't want me for what I do. They want me for a dollar amount. And my experience with that is those people are never going to be happy with what I do for them. And it's ultimately going to be worse for me. Fire truck going by. Sorry about that.
Hey, 10% off.
Right.
There's a firehouse around the corner. So for people who only want me for the price, my experience with those people is they're not going to be satisfied with what I do for them, and they're more likely to give me a bad review online, because they, you know, their expectation is based on what they're paying, not what I can do for them. But you know, I touched on earlier, if someone, you know, if I can discount something $100 to get a $4,000 wedding, then for me, that's an easy choice. But if someone says, you know, someone else is charging half of what you charge for the same thing, which happens, you know, more and more, as more people get into this business, I simply can't do that. I won't do that, because if someone's charging half price, they, you know, they probably don't have the overhead that I do. They're probably not running a business. They're probably running a hobby, which means they're not paying taxes, which means they don't have insurance, which means they're cutting corners in some way. You know, the product they're delivering is not going to be the same. And if someone, you know, if their budget is only X, that's fine. You know, and I'm not going to, you know, I can't apologize to people for you know, charging what I charge, because I charge what I charge based on what I need to run my business and make a living. So while there are times when a discussion can be had and maybe a negotiation can be reached, you know, you can take an hour off, you know, for discounting price. You can, you know, put fewer pages in an album for a lower price. But if someone comes to me and says, this, you know, another person is charging significantly less, can you match them? I just can't do that.
Yeah. It's I was talking to Seth before everyone jumped on. I had a friend of my mother reach out to me to buy a stinky cake. And she's like, well, my budget is $50. I was like, okay, you know, go to the website, let me know what you want, I'll take care of you. Now, I cut out the just go to the website order thing because, you know, my mom's friend, I got to talk to her a little different. So she said, okay, good. She goes on the website, she calls me back. She goes, oh, I saw what was for $50. That's all we get. And I go, yep, you get the diapers, the teddy bear, I'll give you a custom bib to go with it. And yeah, that's what you get. And she go, oh, well, I was hoping we could get more. I go, oh, hey, listen, no worries. I won't take it personal if you go with someone else. I totally understand. I have no problem with you guys going with someone else and getting what you want. And she's like, she was shocked that I said that. But I have no problem firing a customer. I was telling Seth, like, in the beginning, like, when I first started Stinky Cakes, I'd have been like, okay, I'll give you this, I'll give you that, I'll give you this, I'll give you, to get the $50. Then I would look at my numbers, because before I really understood my numbers, which is a big reason why I tell you guys, know your numbers. Like, know my numbers now, like, I would have give up $40 worth of stuff to make 50, which means I'm losing. So that's why I got no problem firing people, because, like, and just like most of you guys, whether you have a dollar store customer or a Bentley customer, you got to still do the same amount of work. It's not like you could not do the same amount of work. You still got to work. You know what I mean? So finding the right customer in your market that pays what you say. If you want to talk about discounts, okay, fine. This is how I look at a discount. If my service is $2,000, and someone's paying $4,000, and I come to them with my $2,000 at the quality they used to, they're going to say, holy crap, yeah, I'm going to go with you. And then at that point, for me, it just introduced me to a new market. That means I should be in that $4,000 customer market, because that's what they would normally pay. And I learned that through just making wrong decisions with Stinky Cakes. Those ladies out in Connecticut, I was charging $50 for my big cakes, right? I didn't know nothing because I was poor. I was dirt poor. So that's why I always talk about a customer base of one. I was making these decisions on what my bank account was like, on what my wallet was like, right? So I was driving out to Connecticut, and these ladies were giving me $50 tips. And, like, dumb me, because I was still stuck in my mindset, like, oh, thank God, you know, this is a black – versus – no, I should be charging $100 because that's what they used to paying for a baby gift. People have budgets in their mind already. Like, if right now someone says, hey, I want a coffee. Someone's thinking $2 Dunkin' Donuts style or the gas station style dollar. And someone's thinking $5 Starbucks. Mm-hmm. So knowing who your customer on what they like, you, I promise you, you won't ever have to beg your customer to pay you what you're worth. You show them the value and they go, yes, this is what I'm looking for.
And there's a Warren Buffett quote, I think it's Warren Buffett, said that price is what you pay, but value is what you get.
Yeah. It's true. Yes. It's funny, someone we were talking to said something, Garnell, the guy, I forgot what he said. I wrote it down, but he said something the same thing.
Yeah, I forgot. It was something like prices only or fees are only present in the absence of value or something like that.
Yeah. I gotta find it.
Yeah, something along the lines of that.
Well, yeah, no, that. I mean, I'm telling you too. Like, in all honesty, I believe the discount thing is two things. Is what switching from a consumer's mindset to producer's mindset, right? As the consumer, you look for the discounts, you see the discounts, and you feel like, okay, I should offer a discount. And then you think of like Walmart. Well, Walmart offers a discount, so they got all these customers. But they buy, the amount of buying that they're doing and the amount of selling they're doing and the amount of volume they're doing, the numbers doesn't just come from one store. It comes from the 500 stores, how many stores they have. So the number ends up being the same thing. So when Walmart sells you a t-shirt for 50 cents and you as a business owner try to sell that same t-shirt for 50 cents, Walmart's profiting $5,000 on that 50 cent t-shirt. And you as a small business owner, you're losing 50 cents on that. So you can't do what the big companies do. Their buying power is different. Their volume's different. Like, everything's different. So you better off spending that time finding who your customer is. And like Garnell, you talked about the video business card and a couple other things. Like just finding your niche, finding who wants what you have and they understand the value that you bring. Like, I promise you right now, if you go to Coach and say, hey, Coach, I have another concept for video. I want to do this. He'll pay the value because he gets it. Like, people, once they understand the value that you bring, like even that video you showed me, the pizza shop, he's like, oh my God, I could do this so much better, right? That's the start of that, but then finding people that understand the value in that, because a lot of people are cheap and a lot of people want something for nothing. But you don't want those people as your customer. Like Seth said, you can't ever please those people. You can't, because they'll be like, well, you said you was gonna use 7 lights to light up my thing, and you only use 5. I need to get $200 off for those other 2 lights. That's what they do. Whereas the people that understand your value, they go, oh my God, you did such a wonderful, that's what they're gonna say. Oh my God, you did such a wonderful job. That's the feedback versus looking for what else can I get for free.
Yeah, 100%.
What do you, next question for you, Seth. I'm just gonna be bugging you all day. you do incredible work. But I'm sure along the lines you've had some people that either weren't as happy, maybe they weren't as ecstatic, or they wanted this, they kind of expect a little bit different, although they've seen your work prior. How do you deal with those people? What do you do in situations like that, if it's happened?
I've been fortunate to not have had very many, if at all, of those experiences. I think part of the reason for that is that I market myself in a very specific way. So the way I market myself and the way I sell myself is self-selecting. So people are going to come to me and they're going to hire me based because they want specifically what I do, right, not because of, for example, my price. And I think that goes back to what we were saying earlier with pricing. So if you're competing on price, that's all people are going to know. And their expectations are only based on what they're paying. But if they're purchasing based on style or value or your experience, they're just not gonna, yeah, well, hopefully they feel like they've gotten their money's worth, but they're not going to be comparing you to other people based on price. They're gonna be comparing what you do based on the quality of your work and your professionalism. So because of that, because I really hit those points very hard on my website, in any of my online marketing, and in person when I meet with people or talk with them on the phone or have a video conference with them, I talk about those things more than I do about price. And price is important to people. I mean, everybody has a budget, and we do this in a commercial vein. So I can't discount the money aspect of this, because people are investing a fair amount of money with us, with what we do. So I want them to feel confident that their investment is well placed. So when you come at it from a perspective of quality and professionalism, rather than what can I give you, what more can I give you, how low can I make my price to get you to sign on, their expectations are going to be different. So I think that's why I fortunately haven't encountered those kinds of couples.
Okay, thank you.
Sure.
Seth, I got a question. How do you define value?
That seems like something I should think about for a while before answering. how do I define value? maybe, okay, this is off the top of my head. I hope I don't embarrass myself here. This is, if people are looking for, maybe if you've exceeded someone's expectations, whether it's based on price or what they think they're getting. I'm going to have to think about that one. I'm going to have to do a second one and answer that question more fully.
No, honestly, I think you nailed it. And I go back to that Henry Ford quote, right? Like, what are people looking for? They wanted a faster horse, right? If I asked them, they wanted a faster horse. So when I create the Model T, that's tons of value. That's giving them everything they wanted and needed and surpassing their expectations. Like, that's value. Like, one of the things we talk about, one of the things we talk about in the 100 Grand Plan, I say, and I sometimes I'm repetitive because sometimes you got to, like, get it, right? Mm-hmm. So, like, how do you become valuable, right? So to me, you become valuable by adding value. You add so much value that you become valuable to someone, right? Once you become valuable to someone, you add a means for a financial transaction to happen, and then they buy, right? In an easy example, if I'm writing content about marketing on my blog, here's how you do this, marketing, I'm giving you like 365 things that you could do with marketing different days. And you keep coming back because you find value in it. You want to know how to market your business. You want to get customers. The thing that you want or need, you learn how to do it, right? So I'm adding tons of value. So now, you keep coming back, you're at the point where my content is valuable to you, right? So now if I take that content or some new content, put it in the how to market your business in 365 days a year book for $19.99 on Amazon, you're going to go and buy that because you find it valuable. So I think you nailed it 100%, like meeting and exceeding people's expectations, however that may be. And that goes, once again, goes back to understanding your customers. If you know, Garnell, that your customer, like the basketball program, if you know that they're looking to get people to come to that clinic, right? So you create the, because they don't know how to do that visually using video. They don't know, right? So you create what they wanted, and plus with understanding their customer, what they need, you create this dynamic video that then in turn tied with a good marketing and advertising campaign brings kids into that basketball clinic. Your video is super valuable, right? So your confidence is going to come from knowing, oh, when I create this thing, the result that they want, they're going to get, right? And that's what they're paying for. They're not even really paying for the video per se. Like with Seth, they're not necessarily paying for the photos per se. They're paying to preserve that memory, how they see it during that day. So when they flip through Seth's photos, they go, oh my, they're not even thinking about Seth. Then they're daydreaming like, Nana was in the background. Oh my God, you're right. That's the value. He delivered that in such a dynamic way. So it's crazy in reverse, right? If Seth had a magic wand that could take those photos out of their hands and go, hey, you want them back? It's going to cost you $100,000. Okay. Here's take my money. Right? So that's think about that. How do I give people what they want or need? How do I exceed the expectations? I promise you guys, that's why Stinky Cakes was killing it. Because all these people that were copying us, they couldn't give that same experience. I was dressed up as a freaking baker with a bacon hat and saying, somebody got a stinky cake. It was about the experience. It wasn't about the diapers. They could have bought a box of diapers. Yes. The value, everything that made Stinky Cake so dope had nothing to do with the diapers. It was all about me understanding what these people really wanted and needed. The second I understood that baby showers are competitive sports, just like the NFL, just like the NBA, and I was like, okay, how can I help my team win? Oh, okay, so you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to go up. We're going to have the stinky cake. We're going to have the person that bought it, and we're going to have the pregnant person. We're going to come together in front of everybody. We're going to take a picture. So really what we're saying, your gift sucks. She didn't take a picture with you and the stinky cake guy. So now that person's the rock star of the baby shower. Like, that's what I'm saying. Be obsessed with your customer and what they really, really want. And if you, I promise you guys, if you get that, it's another one of those things that creates that ATM machine. I haven't advertised Stinky Cakes in it. Maybe, so I've been working on it with this 6-7 years. Still to this day, I just had someone left a voicemail wanting to order one. It's because of the value that people remember these things. Like, Stinky Cakes is so time sensitive and event sensitive. If someone doesn't need a baby gift this weekend, or they don't know someone pregnant, they're never buying one. But they keep it in the back of their mind. My oldest Stinky Cake baby is about 11, 12 years old right now. 11 or 12. So my marketing from 12 years ago still pays off because I understood what the people are looking for and needed. No radio ads, no Facebook ads, no none of that. People still order them. Value.
Okay. So going back to value, my question then becomes, and probably Seth can answer this. So when you do have these meetings, because I imagine once somebody, you know, decides, hey, we like your work, you know, how do we go forward? I know that I was just looking over. I know that they could meet with you or they could chat with you. When somebody meets you, what do you make sure that you hit on? Like, how does a typical meeting for you go? Do you hear what they're looking for and then find ways to, like, also in this field, people don't value. People don't quite understand it. People think a video is a video. You go there, or pictures. You know, you go there, you hit the click the button a couple times, and you know. So even if they think like, hey, I want your quality pictures, how do you? What points do you make to hit? What points do you make sure to hit on to kind of deliver that value and make sure it's valuable to them?
For me, a lot of my consultations, whether it's phone calls or in person, they center a lot around the experience that people are going to have. Because the way I do things is, being more of a documentarian, I don't pull them away from doing what it is that they're there to do, which is enjoy each other and enjoy the experience of the day. So I'm not someone who's going to pull them away to do this, that, or the other thing. You know, I want them to just be themselves. And the more people ignore me and forget I'm there, the happier I am. The best compliments I get are, we didn't even know you were there. And sometimes I'm actually physically close to them to get these photos. I could be a foot, 2 feet away from them, and they see the photos and they know I'm in their personal space, but they have no memory of it. So that's the kind of stuff I try to hit on, that this is the kind of work that I do, that they're going to get something that's genuine, that's not, it doesn't have any artifice, something that's very authentic about themselves and about how the day was flowing. So the points I try to hit are very much about how I'm going to work with them, how they're going to have a better experience with me, how, because I've been doing this for a while, that I can work with whatever family dynamics they happen to have. I always say I've seen it all, but every couple months something new comes up. It's really, I find it very, very, it's amusing to me personally that I have been doing this so long, there's still new things that I'm seeing. And for, as far as weddings go, the family pictures part of the day is one of the few times of the day when people get to encounter my personality, because that's one of the few parts of the day that I'm actually interacting with people, because I will take charge during that part of the day and pose people and make sure people's hands and feet are doing what they're supposed to do to get a good picture. But I also try to do it as efficiently as I can. And I joke around with people, I try to keep it light, because that's the part of the day when people say, you know, it pulls people away from the appetizers and the bar and the dancing. And so I try to give them a good experience during that part of the day. So for me, that value proposition is about experience. The experience they're gonna have with me and the quality of the work that they're going to get because of that experience.
Great, thank you so much.
What you just said sounds like the most perfect profession for an introvert, man. You're like an ninja, yeah, but you're not there. It's just like, I'm here, but I'm not. You know what, Seth, it makes me think of the photos you did for PodCamp. And I didn't know why I loved them so much, but I get it now. Because you got quite a few shots with me doing my thing. And it was like in that natural, and I never seen myself. Normally, if someone takes a picture of me speaking, like you see when they do it, and I'm like, you know, like, and I'm aware of it. But you got a couple of shots. Like, I remember this one. I'm sitting talking to a lady up against the wall as a big picture. I got my legs crossed, and I'm just talking to her. And you caught that. And I was like, yo. Well, I was talking to Tom Fox. I was talking to another one. I could remember the photos you took, right? Because it was like, I never saw myself like that. And it was, for me, it was cool because like people, like they tell me all the time, like what they get from me. And they're like, yeah, I'm just being me. But like to see that moment, then I kind of like understood. You could tell like in the pictures, like you could tell when I'm talking to someone, like I'm really interested. Like it was just cool how you captured it. I get it. I totally get it. But Darnell too, people people that are not your customers, like once you know your value, bro, people that are not your customers won't even be attracted to you, to be honest. It's kind of like with the MLK basketball program. Like, we only attract a certain type of parent that brings a certain type of player. Like how we put ourselves out there, how we message it. We talk about value in fundamentals and discipline and respect and honor. To a lot of people, that's a turnoff. Like, that sounds boring. To parents that are trying to raise respectful kids and leaders in the community, That's what they're trying to teach their kids at home too. So they're attracted to that. And our program could be $1,000 a month. If they find that value in that, the parents are coming for that stuff. The kids are coming for the basketball. But it price is a funny thing. It's really irrelevant, man, when you get all the other elements right. But that's why I tell you guys too, with the 100 grand plan, I always say this, like if I price this thing at 10, 15, 20,000, I would still get buyers. But I go back to the reason I have it at $50 a month is because I go back to Mike Connolly, who would have did all the work if I know what to do, but I wouldn't have been able to afford any more than $50. Like it's targeted towards a certain type of person. And I still market it talking about long, lonely, boring work. That's turning off a lot of people. It's only people that are going to go through the grind that will sign up for that, whether it was a dollar or $1 million. Like once you understand your market, why people buy, how people buy, what to sell to them, how to sell to them, it becomes strategic. It really becomes strategic. So that's a big part of it. It's a puzzle.
Yeah, 100%. And some of that, you know, that lonely, boring work, no one wants to go through their profit and loss statements. You know, that's boring. Well, some people, maybe accountants do.
Accountants love it.
Accountants love that stuff. You know, if you're a numbers person, more power to you. We should talk. Because you know, the fun stuff is the stuff that everybody sees. It's, you know, for me, it's the photos. But as fun as that is, it's the stuff that people don't see that I feel keeps me in business. And that's understanding my numbers, and that's understanding my market. And it's really putting thought into not just the artistic aspects of what I do, but also the behind the scenes stuff that nobody sees. And that's, it's boring and it's not fun. But if you can look at it, I've chosen to look at that kind of stuff as a creative avenue. You know, what can I do to these numbers to get them from here to here? And if I can turn that in my head, if I can make that a creative thing rather than simply a numbers and accounting thing, I pay a little more attention to it. And that's the stuff that I think keeps us in business.
Without a doubt, without a doubt. All righty, man, listen, any other questions before I let F go? See, that's my Caribbean thing, man, the THs, man, because we don't say THs, we say that. We don't say that. We say that. What that is. So saying Steph, I have to like think, because I say think every time.
Well, this was a lot of fun, Mike. Thank you. Thank you so much for having me and for everybody who tuned in. Yeah, this was great. This was an honor to talk to everybody. And, you know, hopefully it was, I wasn't just talking at you. Hopefully we had more of a conversation. This was great. This was great. Thank you.
I think it was great. What did you say, Garnell?
I said, thank you so much, Seth, for everything.
It was my pleasure. Thank you for joining us today.
Seth, how can they reach out to you if they have questions or if they want to hire you or contact info, man?
My website is sethkaye.com, sethkaye. There's some contact info on there. My email address is seth@sethkaye.com, and my Instagram is @sethkaye.
Awesome. Thanks again, man. I'm gonna wrap it up, man. Listen, everyone, there's so many gems in this call today, man. Like, you know, from being an introvert to being knowing your numbers, to understanding your customers, there's so much in here. You want to come back and listen to this again, watch it again. If you're listening to the replay, man, get on these calls live because you're missing the magic of the mastermind. You know, if you're not live, time is the most valuable commodity. Thank you for spending some time with us, man. 100 grand plan. I want you all to succeed. Continue working. Continue doing the LBW. Continue surrounding yourself with people that believe in you. Because you always say entrepreneurship is a roller coaster, man, ups and downs. And it's there for the taking, man. So go be successful. And like Seth said, define your success. Know what that means to you and go get it. I love you all, man. Appreciate you all. Until the next call.